As we're doing the offering, I'm just going to invite Jez up. Jez is preaching this week in our series Against the Flow. Go, woo, there. So can I invite you just to take your seat? So give him a round of applause. It was lovely as Jez arrived today, just to see the affection for him from people around the room as he greeted old friends and people who know him well. But I'm also aware there's been a number of people in the room today who might not know too much about Jez, and so I just wanted to ask you, Jez, yeah, could you let us know a bit about you, what's happened for you and your family since you've moved from here to Seaford?
Lovely to see you. Thank you for having me. I moved from here 13 years ago. We, as part of planting the church over in Seaford, I lead the team at Life Church Seaford. You gave birth to us. You are our mother church. So it's lovely to be back here with you. I originally don't come from a Christian home. Got saved when I was at uni. Met my wonderful wife, Amy. When we left, we got married, moved to Eastbourne, did the kids and youth work for a few years here. And when we left Eastbourne, we had one child, and now we have three, so that's multiplication. So we're very pleased with that. And that's a little bit about me, but I feel really awkward answering that question, so I don't know what to say.
It used to make me laugh, actually. A number of years ago, when you were perhaps establishing Seaford, you'd come across here and you'd be actively trying to sell Seaford to the Eastbourne Congress. You'd come and join us. And actually, I had a course on Friday in Seaford. I was reminded it is a lovely part of the world.
Anybody wants to move there, they're very welcome. It's a great place to be.
And just to explain, that you're not going for the boy band look with the stall on stage, are you? It's because you're nursing a bit of sciatica.
I do. I have sciatica. So I can barely stand at the moment or walk anywhere. So hence, I will be acting like a member of a 90s boy band for a little bit of today. I'll stand up when it's the appropriate key change moment and we can sing together.
Right, well, I'd just take the opportunity to pray for you as we do that. And so, Lord, thank you, Father, that we're in a series about going against the flow. And we just know that our culture around us is so pervasive that it's just so easy to go with the flow. And Lord, we just really want to be a people, though, who are salt and light, who reflect you. And we want to know your values and what you say about areas in our lives, Father. And so just would you fill Jez today with your Holy Spirit? Would you have him to communicate clearly what's on his heart as well? And would you draw us close to the Father heart of God in all of this? In your mighty name, amen.
Amen. Thank you, Ben. Bless you. Well, wow. Wow, what an absolute treat for me to be here with you. Less of a treat for my friend Chris, who's part of the church in Seaford, and he thought, I'll have a morning off and come to Eastbourne this week. Sorry, mate, you got me again. But it is a real privilege to be here and to see so many friendly and familiar faces, and if I don't know you yet, it's lovely to meet you. It was a privilege. I met Ethan a moment ago, because I saw Ethan on telly, on the internet, and I was like, there's a famous man. So I went over and introduced myself. What an inspiring story. And actually, I said to Ollie, I'd love to be able to preach to Ethan and share about Jesus with Ethan and people like Ethan, so that's what I'm here to do a bit. My question as we start, though, is do we have any rebels in the house today? Any rebels? I know you're a rebel. That's true. I know you're a rebel. The thing is, Jesus was a rebel. You ready? A rebel. He was a rebel. Outlaw, sanctified, troublemaker, but he never sinned, no. And he lived his life by a different set of rules. The culture don't approve, that's so you know they have to prove him. That's the way. Okay. There we go, that's enough of that. Jesus was a rebel, and this morning it's my privilege to speak into your sermon series that you've called Against the Flow, as we're looking at various aspects where we as Christians need to be aware of perhaps where the flow of culture is and where we need to stand against that as followers of Christ. I'm going to be reading today from Romans chapter 12, verses 1 to 8. Here we go. I appeal to you, therefore, brothers and sisters, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind. And that's an important bit. We can't just rebel. There's lots of rebels out there. And often you see this, people rebel against something in culture and they run straight into the arms of the equal but opposite error. And I see this in the church all the time. Rebel against what they see and then they just become nasty or bigoted in return. No, we have to be renewed by the perfect water of the Word of God. Be renewed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. For by the grace given to me, I say to every one of you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think with sober judgment, each according to the measure of faith that God has assigned. For as in one body we have many members, and the members do not all have the same function, so we, though many, are one body in Christ, and individually members one of another. Having gifts that differ according to the grace given to us, let's use them. If prophecy in proportion to our faith, if service in our serving, the one who teaches in his teaching, the one who exhorts in his exhortation, the one who contributes in generosity, the one who leads with zeal, and the one who does acts of mercy with cheerfulness. This is the word of God. And we're going to return to that passage together later, but this, first of all, I want to introduce a subject that we're going to be talking about that is a passion of mine, something that Ollie asked me to speak on, and something that I do believe is against the flow of our culture. And that is the need to talk about and the need to focus on the importance of raising boys. Now, before I go any further and alienate 50% of the room, I need to answer the question, why on a morning like this morning, should we, in a mixed sex gathering like this, do we need to talk about and think about the subject of raising boys? 13 years ago, I had my first son, a boy, and Rachel Michael gave me a book called Raising Boys. In fact, I think she lent it to me, but I've still got it. So technically, I've stolen it. So here's me apologizing before we carry on, okay? There we go. Now, I'm not unaware or naive about the challenges faced by our girls and women in society. Today is not about, in any way, trying to say that men are bigger victims or have it harder than women. That would be ridiculous. In fact, in the past year alone, we have seen in the media reports of widespread sexual assault and abuse taking place in many of our national institutions, in the church, in the NHS, in government, in the BBC, and even in McDonald's, all in the past year. And I'm aware that there are challenges that I know nothing about faced by so many women every day just to have their voices heard. So why talk about raising boys? Well, firstly, I have boys. I have three sons. So I don't know anything about raising girls. Secondly, I feel prophetically this is something that God has given me for the church for this time. But thirdly, let's be honest, many of the challenges faced by women result from men and boys behaving badly towards them. 95% of all women murdered are killed by boys or men. And of those, 50% of women who are murdered are killed as a result of intimate partner violence, that is domestic abuse. And a man, because of his superior strength and size, is capable of doing far more harm to a woman than she is to him. The feminist writer Louise Perry, she says this, "Any feminist analysis of the power dynamic between men and women has to begin with the recognition of this fact. The unwelcome truth will always remain, whether or not we can bear to look at it, that almost all men can kill almost all women with their bare hands, but not vice versa. And that matters." And so, for the sake of our women and our girls, we need to talk about raising boys. And fourthly, and now I do need to sit down, sorry about this. Fourthly, there is a need for it. We're living through a time, this feels very strange, so I'm leaning on my desk to talk to you. We are living through a time when young people's childhood is being re-engineered. Moral psychologist Jonathan Haidt calls this the great rewiring. With the arrival of the smartphone and of social media, young people's social habits have changed. They're spending far less in-person time with other humans and are, as a result, far lonelier than previous generations. Young people are taking longer to grow up and to reach the milestones typically associated with adulthood. Young people are facing an epidemic of mental health crisis, and they're also experiencing a decline around the optimism that they have for their own futures. And all of this is happening at a time and in societies where fewer and fewer young people have secure or stable home lives or families. It's estimated that 50% of all children will see their parents divorce or separate by the time they turn 16, and one in three households in the UK are fatherless. That is the highest rate of male or father absence at any time since World War II. And it's been shown that for every 1% increase in fatherlessness in a community, they see a 3% increase in youth violence. Because the truth is, hurting boys hurt people. Boys, like girls, need to know that they are accepted and included. But boys, unlike girls, often turn to dangerous and violent means to achieve that sense of inclusion that they so often crave. It's what gangs are about. And in a society like this, with so many boys hurting and largely adrift from the positive influence of male figures in their lives, they are looking for shepherds, people to care for them. When Jesus saw the crowd in Matthew chapter 9, it says that he saw the crowd and he had compassion on them because they were like sheep without a shepherd. And there is a longing in the hearts of every child, every boy, for a good shepherd. In 2020, a man named Rob Kenny started a YouTube channel entitled Dad, How Do I? And in this channel, he teaches some basic life skills like changing a tire, having a shave, learning to tie a tie, jumpstart a car, that sort of thing. It's a lovely channel where every video begins with him saying, "Hey kids," and then teaching them something. Within months of starting his channel, he had 3 million subscribers. And the comments, many of them by young men, are often quite heartbreaking. One of them reads, "My father left when I was 6 and I've not heard from him since. Thank you for being the dad I never had. Thank you for being the light in a broken and dark world." Sadly, it's not only shepherds that are around, but wolves as well. And our sons increasingly are becoming easy pickings and easy targets for wolves, or for toxic expressions of manhood. Take Andrew Tate, for example, a name known to many of us, described as the king of toxic masculinity. Andrew Tate last year was the third most Googled person in the world. He has over 9 million followers on Twitter, and his online university entitled The Real World, where he teaches men about masculinity, it's amassed more than 450 million views of its content in just over 2 years. Perhaps closer to home and more on our streets than Andrew Tate. In the UK, there are criminal organisations and networks known as County Lines that preys on vulnerable young people, enlisting them to sell and pass on and hold for them drugs. In 2015, there were about 7 police forces reported County Lines behaviour in their districts. By 2019, it was 44 police forces reporting that. The main victims of County Lines are boys, age 15 to 17 years old. Now, it may be an extreme example, but history tells us that boys, when they're vulnerable to shepherdly or wolfish influences, can be a dangerous force. In the 1920s, Germany, Nazis capitalized on a generation of fatherless boys, result of World War I, and indoctrinated them with their evil ideologies. We could go on. We could talk about the fact that in every one of the world's 63 most developed nations, boys are falling behind girls in education, in life expectancy, and in quality of life. Now, the goal in all of this, of course, isn't to say that we must do better than the girls. No, of course, for decades, girls have been struggling. But the difference is that when girls were struggling, we listened to voices, we heard, we cared, we invested. There's still a long way to go, but we're at least open to those changes. The goal isn't that boys do better than girls because, of course, in the battle of the sexes, when one sex loses, both sexes lose. Whilst it's true that the majority of high-earning, wealthy people or CEOs in the country are male, it's also true at the opposite end of the spectrum. Men often occupy the margins in society. So of the 98,000 prisoners in the UK, 96% of them are male. Boys and men are far more likely than women to become addicted to video games, to porn, alcohol, and drugs. In fact, just touching on pornography for a moment, this is what some have called the unspoken epidemic in our society. In a sexualized, highly sexualized culture like ours that invests so much time, energy, and effort in our sexual identity, in a culture like this, it's no wonder that boys are becoming addicted, and increasingly so, to porn. According to one YouGov poll, 36% of men, 4% of women, admit to once a week viewing pornography. And 25%, one in four, 25% of 18 to 30-year-olds admit to watching porn every day. What does that do to the relationships between the sexes? What does that do to how you think about the other half? In China, they have an expression that translates as the female is on the way up, the male is on the way down. The world's answer, many and various, one of them, national service. The truth is that for almost all cultures in almost all of history, its communities and customs have had traditions to help boys transition from childhood and boyhood into manhood. Almost all cultures, except for the modern West. And how's that working out for us? I put it to you, King's Church Eastbourne, that we need to see a movement begin that takes this sort of thing seriously and sees and empowers deliberate, intentional approaches to raising sons of courage and character. The Catholic writer Richard Rohr, he says that left to himself, the male has often been seen as being a dangerous and even destructive element in society. In some ways, he says, women were historically initiated by their one-down position in patriarchal societies, or by the humiliations of blood, that is menstruation, or by the ego-decentralizing role of child-raising, and by their greater investments in relationships. He says, generally speaking, women have been initiated and understood what it means to be a woman through natural things or social things. Men, he goes on to say, men have always seemed to need a womp on the side of the head or a fall from the proverbial tower or their own blood humiliation, think circumcision, in order to become positive, contributing or wise members of the larger community. A womp on the side of the head. I know some boys that could do that. Let me tell you about a friend of mine. We'll call him Tom. On the age, when he turned 13, which is the age that many boys and many cultures are initiated into a pathway of manhood. When he turned 13 on Father's Day, his dad wrote the family a letter to say that he'd found another woman and was leaving them. Because it was Father's Day, his sisters had come home from university to spend time as a family, but when they heard this news, they promptly returned. Tom said that his family went overnight from being what he thought was a happy, functional home to being just him and his mum. And that was it. He hasn't seen his dad since. Feels a bit depressing, doesn't it? not really a happy-go-lucky kind of moment, not many laughs. But what do we do? How are we feeling? What's our hope? How do we respond to this sort of thing? Well, I don't think that the answer is just to say, dads, do better. Neither is the answer to say, mums, try harder. In fact, if you said that, you'd probably get a slap. Mums, understand, reasonably so. Mums, try harder, you wouldn't say that. First thing to say is this. Boys and young men, if you're here this morning, I just want to say we're so glad you're here. God has a purpose for you. You're not a destructive force in this world. But God loves you, and we're thrilled that you're here and part of this family. I want us to return to our Bible passage to explore some of what the answer might be and why I think we need to see the establishment and emergence of a movement that takes this sort of thing seriously. So Romans chapter 12, this is what it says. How does it begin? It says, I appeal to you, therefore, brothers and sisters, by the mercy of God. So the first question I ask is, who's he appealing to, first of all? Who does Paul appeal to? I appeal to you, he says, but the you is not you, just sat on your own, on your Todd, on that chair. He's not appealing to you on your own, but to all of you, plurally. The Americans have an expression, instead of you, they say y'all, don't they? So this could read, I appeal to y'all, therefore, I appeal to y'all. You on your own are not being called upon to change the world. Thank goodness, because I can't even change the clock on my microwave. And then it isn't just you, kind of nameless, faceless crowd. It's actually you, brothers and sisters. And this expression, this word, though it seems simple and incidental, you may think, oh, it's just a kind of causal greeting, some of the casual greeting that Paul uses. There is more to this than I think we often appreciate and take seriously. The Apostle Paul is not writing to men and women. In fact, here's a thought. I don't think the Bible ever tells you to man up or be a man. I don't think it ever tells you to be a woman. And here's what womanhood, here's what manhood looks like. In fact, I don't think the Bible ever appears to you having an identity that is just solely arrived at on the basis of your biology and body. And your body can tell you everything you need to know about manhood and womanhood. Now, of course, our bodies tell us things about what it means to be a man, what it means to be a woman. But the Bible doesn't go there when it wants to say what a man or a woman is. Do you know what the Bible says? It says we're made male and female, yes. But how should we live as male and female? You know what the Bible says? It addresses you and me in relational terms. You know what it means to be a good man? Well, the Bible just says, be a brother, be a father, be a husband, and be a woman, be a good godly woman, be a sister, be a mother, be a wife. In other words, it's all about relational embeddedness. So I appeal to you, brothers and sisters. And what's the motivation in front of them? He says, by the, or in view of, the mercies of God. Paul doesn't guilt trip the church and say, come on, live differently. Be transformed by the renewal of your mind, because you ought to. And there's a great need for you to sort it out. Can you just sort your lives out and get on with it? And if you don't, no one will. He doesn't come to the church and say, come on, there's a big need out there. Go out into the world and make as much effort as you can. Try harder. Doesn't say that. He doesn't say, come on, you can do this, brothers and sisters. Change the world, because you are really clever. And some of you are really clever. Not you. You are written. No, you are. Some of you are really clever and really gifted and talented. I know that. There's a saying, isn't there? By the time you realize your dad was right, you'll have a son who thinks you're wrong. And you are right. There's lots about you that is very clever. But Paul doesn't say, this is your motivation. Do these things. There's a great need. No, no, he says, in view of the mercies of God. Drink deep of the mercies of God. In view of how he has treated you, in light of how he has showered his mercy upon you. And if you're anything like me, I was an abject failure. I was a sinner and an idolater and hated God. And then he showed mercy to me, forgave me, adopted me, set my feet clear, and gave me a purpose and a lane to run in. And now it's the way that he's treated me, the light that he's shown to me by his mercy. That's what's meant to motivate us. The word mercy that Paul uses, the Greek word can be translated compassion or kindness in relieving sorrow, favor, or grace. See, as with anything in your life, as with anything in the Christian life, it begins by, first of all, being ravished by the love of God. I really appreciated your worship time. Wow, what a time to enjoy God's goodness. There's this great poem written by, I think it's a Scottish man called John Donne. And it begins, batter my heart, three-person God. And then it ends, unless you enthrall me, I'll never be free. I'll never be of any use to anybody unless I'm enthralled by, captivated by the love of God. So he addresses his brothers and sisters and he says, here's your motivation in view of the mercies of God. And then he goes on to talk to them about how to live a renewed life. He says, be transformed by the renewal of your mind, sure. And then he says, do this in the next few verses. And I think there's a clue for us. And it's at this point that you realize, I'm really not talking to 50% of the room, but to all of us. This is what he says in verses 4 to 8 of Romans 12. For as in one body, we have many members, and the members do not all have the same function. So we, though many, are one body in Christ, and individually members of one another, having gifts that differ according to the grace given to us. Let's use them. If prophecy in proportion to our faith, if service in our serving, the one who teaches in his teaching, the one who exhorts in his exhortation, the one who contributes in generosity, the one who leads with zeal, the one who does acts of mercy with cheerfulness. How's it going to be done that the church can turn the world upside down? How's it going to be done that we can sort out the boy crisis and raise sons? How do we make known the presence of God? How do we display God's glory in the world? How do we heal hurts? How do we bind up broken hearts? Here's how. And the answer is always the same. The church, you lot, with the mercy of God in you, on you, the gift of God in you, on you. Because here's the thing, Jesus, although you can't see him, and he sent his spirit, Jesus is here in the person next to you. So their hands, their hugs, their words, their arms, their feet, their kindness, that is described as being Jesus' body. Jesus' hands, his feet, his arms, his leg, his eyes and ears and mouth and nose, head, shoulders, knees and toes. That's you lot. You see, if it's true, and I think it is, that the church is going to exist for all eternity, then what we begin to see is that the people sat around you, they're going to be your brothers and sisters forever. Even the annoying ones, which I'm sure there's none here, and I don't have any in my church, our church, Chris, do we? No. So you may be a husband to this woman now, or a wife to this man now, but your marriage ends at death, whereas your fraternity lasts for eternity. The fraternal is eternal. We could keep going. But this has huge implications. It has implications for how we do church. Let's just talk about that, because that person may be your son or your daughter, or your mother, your father, your husband, your wife now, but they're really only that until death. And then at death, it's just brothers and sisters for eternity in God's presence together. You see, a husband and wife relationship, really the purpose of it is just to image Christ and the church to the world. The husband's supposed to play the part of Jesus, the wife's supposed to play the part of the church, and it's a big drama, and they display God to one another and the gospel to the watching world. But as soon as you come through those doors, drop the act. Because it is an act, isn't it? Because actually, the thing that will last forever is your brother and sister with one another. That's really significant. So when you come to church, you can sit next to your wife if you want. If you want, but you haven't got to. Because actually, you're sat around brothers and sisters. And that's your primary identity card when you come here. This is my brothers and sisters. Here we are as a family. And what that means is, if you've got kids and you're doing your best, I know you're doing your best at home to raise them. The thing is, when you come here, you should be able to say, I'll hand over to my other brothers and sisters. I've had enough. I've done my best, and that's why they're so screwed up. But you have a go and see if you can do something. So it means that when we serve in the children's and youth work or wherever we're serving brothers and sisters of brothers and sisters. We're loving our brothers and sisters. We're caring for them, and we're strengthening our bond as a family that will last forever. You see, the world has answers like national service, and I don't know if that's a good thing or a bad thing. But it's sad that we think, the answer is we'll give our kids to the army. When actually God said, well, I've given them a family and I've given them a church family, and you should do that. You should take responsibility for one another. Help one another, right? You know, I saw this infographic a while ago of, you know, you hear these stats, don't you, of young people leaving the church. Apparently 75% of all 18 to 30-year-olds who were raised in church leave church. But the infographic was asking the question, why did those who didn't leave church, why did they stay? Why did the 25% stay? Do you know one of the key reasons? Because they had good relationships with people who weren't their mum and dad in the church, like older men and women who brothered them and sistered them and loved them. So they stayed and they got to know the Lord as a result. See, this sort of thing really requires a degree of intentionality that many of us aren't used to. And if we're honest, I haven't got time for. But if we care, And if we're motivated by the mercies of God, we may put one foot in front of the other. It requires more men and women, brothers and sisters, to actively lean in, whether through prayer, through sponsoring. You know, a few years ago as a church, we had that phrase here, it takes a village or it takes a church to raise a child. So whether serving, whether actively encouraging, or just smiling at young people, giving our boys a pat on the back. If they're fighting in the corridor, saying, well, who won? Well done. Don't demonize them for just trying to work out what it means to be a child in church. So I've been quite motivated by this sort of thing, as you can probably tell. And my eldest son, Riley, he turned 13 last year. And so we set up a group in the church called Intentional Fathers, and we met fortnightly to, first of all, as dads deal with some of our issues, because, you know, if we don't heal our hurts, we end up passing them on, or pain that isn't transformed gets transferred. And so we reviewed our own lives, and as dads try to sort our own hearts, and we had men sit around and talk about their experience of being fathered and their intentions to be a father, and it was very moving. And when my son turned 13, I'd planned this initiation moment, because I thought, I want to lean in at this time. He's going to start becoming a man. And so on his 13th birthday, Amy took him out for lunch, and she gave him two gifts. She gave him a gift that celebrated his childhood, something that meant something to him, and she gave him a gift to prepare him for adulthood, gave him his first Bible, and she wrote in it. And then she dropped him off with me. I was with his other brothers, who they waved him off, and Riley and I went for a hike. We went for like a, I don't know, 6 or 7K hike along the hills in Seaford. And I gave him a heavy backpack, and I gave him a stone to carry. And along the way, I got things out of his backpack, gifts that I'd given him, stuff to do with his childhood, stuff to books and things to prepare him for a man. And then for the last kilometre, let him walk by himself along the cliffs of Seaford, and I went round to the beach and hoped that he'd join me. And at the beach, I had some other men from the church who are part of this community come and join me, if we put this photo up. And we gathered round, and each of the men who had been influential in his life or who were influential in his future, they said one thing they appreciated about him as a young boy. And then they gave him some fatherly wisdom for future, things that they wished they knew when they were 13. And then I told him, I said, over the next few years, we're going to start, along with these men, trying to help you transition effectively to manhood. You see, there's this beautiful story. I read some different initiation ceremonies that cultures around the world have done. And one of them that really moved me was that on the child's 13th birthday, the men from the community gathered outside the house and they called, "Send out a son of our people." And so, send out a son of our people. So here he was, a son of our people. And I said, over the next few years, we're going to take you on 5 different shifts. I said, childhood, first of all, childhood is a life of ease, but men learn to embrace difficulty. And so, that's why I've been making you carry this rock all the time. And so I got the men with him to sign the rock, sign their name on the rock. And then secondly, I said that children think that life is all about them, but men learn to serve. So I gave him an embroidered tea towel. Who doesn't want one of them? Thirdly, I said, children think that they are the whole part of the story. But I said, men learn to realize that they're not the whole story, but they can play a meaningful part. So I gave him a framed Bible verse. Fourthly, I said to him, children think they're going to live forever, but men realize that they're going to die one day. And so I took some ash from the fire because we were cooking a barbecue, and I put some ash on his forehead. And I said, may your death be on your mind often. And then I got him to take his shirt off. And I'd been carrying some mud with me from our garden, and I say, may our home always be close to your heart. And I have set up a trust fund for counseling when he's older. And then fifthly, I said to him, children want to control everything, but men learn to trust and surrender. And so me and his granddad, we took him into the stormy ocean, which you can just see on the bottom right, and we dunked him into the water and pulled him up out. And the people cheered, and we said, welcome, son of our people, you're a man now. And then ever since then, as we've been meeting, Riley and I, 3 mornings a week to do some Bible study and devotional, and I'm trying to draw in different men in his life. And so for September to December, we did a shift from ease to difficulty, and it ended with his uncle, who ran a muddy assault course. We'll go to the next slide. Ran a muddy assault course for him. You see that with his uncle this, in December. That was cold. And then a couple of weeks ago, we just finished a shift learning that children think life's about them, but men learn to serve. So we took him to Turkey, actually, where some friends of ours were doing some relief work after the earthquake, and he spent a week doing stuff there and helping people in Turkey. Now, I share that not to be like, hey, look at me. But, you know, the truth is I may be one step ahead some of you, but I'm miles behind many others of you. I share that because I think it dawned on me on that day when we did that around the beach. It dawned on me that I think this is what intentional discipleship looks like. To grab hold of someone and to say, I'm going to invest in you. And I'm going to meet with you and I'm going to love you and I'm going to champion you. I'm going to cheer you on. See, this isn't about trying to produce perfect Christian kids. You know, salvation belongs to the Lord. I can't decide whether my kids come to faith. Of course I can't. But I can decide to be intentional. It's to say this, that Netflix and social media or the school of hard knocks, those aren't going to be the things that we rely on to teach our sons and daughters and raise them. The church is. We are. You are. You know, we're living at a time that is witnessing a decline in church attendance, the erosion of family life, increased suffering, mental health of young people, and the demonizing of men and masculinity. We're also seeing the rising influence of philosophies and religions, particularly in some of our major cities, that appeal to and call out some of the darker instincts in men, but appeal to men in their thousands. Many of those philosophies and religions are unashamedly patriarchal and misogynistic. Meanwhile, the church often just hires a 20-year-old and runs a youth group and thinks, that'll do it. Now, I was a youth leader. I ran a youth group, but I knew that that didn't do it. It takes a church. It takes hearts that have been battered by the mercies and the love of God. It takes men and women who've been moved with compassion for the suffering of people. It takes churches that long to see girls and women protected and honored in their community. It takes churches that are therefore willing to step up, to listen to love young boys, and to shepherd them to become purposeful, life-giving, protective, and committed men whose hearts are after God. My friend Tom that I told you about, his church youth worker got hold of him, brought him into his home, loved him, let him live there for a few years. He's now a pastor of a New Frontiers church. King's Church Eastbourne, in view of the mercies of God, don't overlook the need to raise your sons well. Let's pray. Lord, I thank you for this just delightful group of people that you love so passionately. I thank you, Lord, that you have given them such soft hearts to want to respond to your word. And I pray, Lord, for a commissioning and a calling out and an establishing of a moment and a movement where for the sake of our young ones, for the sake of our girls and women, we would do all that we can to raise boys to become men of courage and godly character. We sung it at the start, Father. We are the church. We're the hope of the world because your mercies have utterly undone us and transformed us. So I thank you for all the different gifts in the room. I thank you that this isn't a solo fishing endeavor, but a group one. And I ask, Spirit of God, that you'd lead us in the way we should go. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you. Thank you for having me.